guy's got more nicknames than James Brown. Red, Bobby Jean, Bullet. Here we go all the way back to Humes High School, about 1948. We played on the same junior league baseball teams and all. Of course, Red went on to be a sports star, All-Memphis in football and baseball for Humes High School. But Red, what I want to get to, as at Humes High School, the story goes, and I want to hear it from you, exactly how it happened. You're up on the third floor bathroom at Humes High School.
Yeah.
Elvis is in there, and you pick up the story.
Well, you know, I know that we weren't close. It was a small school. We knew each other. Elvis was always different. As he made more progress later on in the music industry, he had to be different. Well, he was the same way in high school, but nobody knew who Elvis was then. You know, I just knew him casually. And I happened to walk in the bathroom one day, and the bullies, three guys were going to, two were holding him, and they were going to cut his hair.
Yeah.
Because we all had crew cuts, and his hair was back, long.
Yeah.
And we're just going to cut his hair, and I happened to walk in. I said, "What's going on?" He said, "Oh, we're going to give him a haircut." I said, "Don't look like he wants the haircut." we're not going to hurt him. Yeah. I said, no. If you cut his hair, you're going to cut my hair. And I had a crew cut, and I said, "I don't think you can do that." And they saw that I was serious, and they backed off. And that was it.
That was really the bonding of you and Elvis.
Yeah.
He never forgot that.
No, I know he didn't.
First of all, you were the first official bodyguard Elvis hired. Yeah. How did that happen?
Yeah. I was getting on, I was a year behind. We were going to play Bartlett in a scrimmage game. Now, I was getting on the bus. Elvis had had, two records out, I think.
Yeah.
And he happened to drive up in that little green, whatever that car was he was driving.
Green Lincoln, yeah.
I was just getting ready to get on the bus to go out to Bartlett. And he got out of the car, and I saw him, and I was real proud. I hadn't seen him since he had these records. Hey, man. And I walked over, and we had a conversation, and he said, "How would you like to go with me on some of these one-niners around, And I said, "Hey, I'm fine." So I started going. And, I'd stand backstage, and I'd see all this commotion going on. I said, "What's going on here, And that was it.
You once told me down somewhere along, early on in Elvis's career, he said, "Here, Red, I'm going to give you one of my guitars," or something.
He gave me that. When I was going to college, when I got the scholarship.
Jones County.
We were on the road coming back from a one-night stand somewhere. We were driving through Corinth, Mississippi. All of a sudden, he hit the brake, swerved, and went in. I'm sitting in the car waiting. He came out, handed me some car keys, and said, "That's yours over there." It's an A model, 1927 A model.
Really?
And I said, "Man, okay, thank you." And he said, "Go on, drive on home." So he took off. And I started this. I didn't know. Man, they had all these levers and stuff that I'd never seen before, spark and gas. But it turned on, and I drove that thing to Memphis. And I was leaving for college like the next week. Went out to Elvis, and he said, "Now here's my old guitar." Because Scotty Moore had been teaching me how to, thank God for Scotty Moore, taught me to play the guitar enough to write a few songs.
Right.
So keep practicing the guitar. This is my old guitar.
A lot of people don't know you're a tough guy, Golden Glove guy, mm-hmm. football guy, boxer, street fighter, whatever. But you had so much talent. I remember the Humes High Talent Show, you played trumpet in the same show that Elvis was on that he won. Now, here we go again, and now all of a sudden you were with Elvis, and you're writing songs. You wrote some of his greatest songs. Separate Ways was a number one song that you wrote for Elvis. It was going about the time that he was having with Priscilla. And then, of course, you wrote If Every Day Was Like Christmas, which is one of his signature Christmas songs, and that is now considered a standard Christmas song.
Yeah.
And people wouldn't believe that Red West would write those songs. Talk about that.
I didn't believe it either. But Scotty Moore, he saw me mess around with guitar when we were on the road. In those days, it was just Elvis, Scotty, Bill, and me. And he drew out the chords on a paper, you know, finger goes here and this fret and this, you know, where the fingers go. And I practice. I learned the basic chords, you know, with a couple of minors in there. And went to California years later when Elvis was still in the Army and I had come back. I went out and met Dorsey and Johnny Burnett, who were from Memphis, and writing songs for Ricky Nelson.
Right, right.
And I said, heck, I can do that. So I started writing, and I wrote a song, got it to Pat Boone, and it was a million seller.
Backside of Moody Blue.
Moody River sold a million, so that other side sold the same amount.
Red, if every day was like Christmas, we could talk 30 minutes on that. We'd have the time. But give me an abbreviated version, sort of a Reader's Digest version, of how it all happened with Every Day Was Like Christmas.
I don't know how it happened. It's like it came from up here, because, you know, we were going to the movies, and I'm in the movie, and it's August, I think, and it hit me. I'm not interested in this movie. I want to go write. I think I mentioned you. You want to go with me? I feel like writing something. And you said, oh, no, man.
It's August, man. I'll write a Christmas song.
So I went home, and we were staying at my in-law's house, Pat and I. And I wrote, if every day was like Christmas, and I don't know, 35, 40 minutes. So.
Is that right?
Yeah, it just...
But it's, I recall, Red, you go out to Graceland, it's a great story, with a dub, acetate, a demo, and what happens?
Well, I went to Chip Smallman, who was over at, where was he at then, before American? I don't know, where he was.
Oh, he's at Stacks.
Yeah, Stacks, that's right. Went over and cut this demo, and turned out great, and ran out there. It was a night or something. Elvis was in the bedroom. I knocked on the door. I said, man, I want you to hear this. He said, well, slide it under the door. So I did. I slid it under the door. And the next day, he said, that was pretty good. He said, I'll do that on the next session. And
this was 2 weeks before Christmas.
Yeah.
So we couldn't get in that fast and cut it.
Yeah.
So then what happened?
So I cut it, released it.
And I played it.
And you played it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I missed that year. But then he came back and record it, like you said, it would, you know, for the next Christmas. And that's when it came out.
Bullet, Bobby Jean, Red West, it's been great, my man. We finally got it down on video.
Yes, sir.
Many years from now, young people can go to the library studios and pull out this video, and there you are telling the whole story.
Yeah, part of it.
Part of it. Hey, Red, thanks a lot here.
Thank you, George.
My man, Bobby Jean, Bullet, Red West, George Klein, Memphis South.